Hi guys, how are you guys doing? I hope all of you are staying home and are doing absolutely fine, taking care of yourself and your loved ones. A very warm welcome to this session. I'm Ankana, your master teacher for social sciences at Vedantu. And this is one of the most awaited sessions, I think. And I think I keep saying that for almost every session, but why I'm saying this is, like, we're finally getting started with the English sessions, and a lot of you kept on requesting that, ma'am, please teach in English. And when we started with class 10th or some other grade or some other board, I would receive requests for like CBSE, 9th, history, geography, this and that. And we're finally getting started with CBSE 9th, first chapter of history. So I hope this helps you. I hope you enjoy this. And if you do, and this was a session that you were really, really waiting for, on that note, just hit the like button, okay? So guys, what's the approach that we're going to take? Now, usually what happens that we end up hating history, and that's why I get this question a lot, like, ma'am, how do you like history? So the reason I like history is that I do not read it in form of, you know, that I'm trying to grasp the dates or some facts from it, but instead in a form of a story, and it becomes so interesting. I think that's the approach that we're going to try to take through our sessions now onwards. And I would request you to do the same. Whenever you're reading the chapter or whenever you're listening to my explanations, try and imagine these events in form of a story. Like, suppose this is scene one, scene two, and that will help you visualize the chronology of the events, and it will be so, so simple for us to understand history then. So let's try and do that, okay? And let's get started with the session. So today we're going to talk about French society in the late 18th century. French society in terms of a society of estates, the struggle to survive that the people had to go through, the growing middle class, ideas of philosophers, and the outbreak of revolution. And in the end, I do have a surprise for you, so stay tuned. That's something very important coming at the end of the session, so make sure that you watch the session till the end. Okay guys, so let's talk about the French society in the late 18th century. So we're basically going to discuss how in the late 18th century, which means somewhere maybe post 750, somewhere between 750s to 1800. What happened between this? So with the way, first thing that we're going to discuss about the condition of France, and why the condition of France that is pertained, what another changes were happening simultaneously. So in 1774, King Louis XVI, who was a part of the Bourbon family, the Bourbon dynasty, which was there ruling at that time, came to the throne. Okay, he took up the throne, and he was just 20 years old when he did that. Okay, when he took up the throne, when he became the king of France, At the same time, he also got married to an Austrian princess called Marie Antoinette. Okay, so what are the two major things that's happening? There's a new king in 1774 who's just 20 years old. At the same time, he's also getting married to one of the Austrian princes called Marie Antoinette. But as I told you, the condition of the condition of France at that time is what we majorly need to focus on. Now see, whenever a new king comes, just like a new monitor comes in your class, he or she wants to make certain changes. They want to work on certain things, right? Similarly, the new king also had the eagerness of working on the country or doing something. Positive, negative, we do not know. But the condition of the country was not really favorable for him. And why is that? So France had been a part of war for very, very long number of years, because of which the treasury, okay, the money of the country was already drained out when the king came to the throne, okay, when the king took over the power. At the same time, under him, he decided to also support the 13 colonies of America in fighting their common enemy, which was Britain, and getting freedom from them. Now, it was not a very well thought through process, okay, because already the treasury was drained out. Now, on top of that, while helping America, whatever money was there, it just went up, okay, and it resulted in the country being in a lot of debt. As a result of this, America did gain their independence with the help of France, which was in a great deal, But the problem that happened was with friends. It was like you help your friend, you maybe show your answers, and who ends up getting more marks? Your friend. And you end up losing more marks maybe for cheating or something. So the same thing happened with friends. So America got independence, America got financial assistance, but America never returned the money that they took from France, and France was just getting more and more indebted. As a result of which, they ended up having a debt of more than 2 billion livres. And we will know what livres is. Livres is, guys, basically the currency of France at that time. Okay. Now, where did they get the money from? The country obviously did not have so much money in abundance. Already their treasury was empty while the king came. And on top of that, they decided to help America, which required even more money and finances to support the war. Now, this money was basically, you can say, borrowed from other people. Now, these people, whoever lended money, people, country, whoever, were now charging great interest on the money that was lent to France, more than 10%. Now, in order to pay off these 10%, they had to get money. And the on top of that, their expenses were not falling less. Okay, there were other things that had to be kept going, which were like cost of maintaining the army, court, government offices, etc. And France has always been this fancy country which is not compromised on its, you know, fanciness, you can say. So all these things were something that they were not compromising on. On top of that, they had debt and high interest to pay for. The treasury was already drained out. Now, all of this as a result, what happened, all of this together resulted in increase of taxation over people. Now, why was tax increased? So if you see, in order to run the country, the government requires money. And now this money by our great king, by the great king of France, had already been spent on wars. So they needed more money. Where will they get this money from? So as a result of this, they decided that the government has to run, everything has to be taken care of. So they imposed increased taxes over people. Okay. Chalo, theek hai, now that they have imposed taxes over people, maybe this will work out for people. But that was not it. There was some problem with this taxation. Now, in order to understand that, let's move forward and understand how the society in France at that time looked like. So the society in France at that time was divided in three estates. Okay, you can understand for a better understanding, we can say like how we have caste system in India. We have different castes over here, which divides the society in different, you can say, segments. Similarly, at that time, France, the society of France was divided in three estates. Okay, you can say three segments. Now, who were these three segments? So the first segment was clergy, which were basically guys, the religious people who had some kind of religious association, were religiously important, like priests, fathers, bishops, etc. The second state was nobility. Okay, now who were these noble people? Now all of the noble people necessarily did not come from the royal family who was in power at that time. For example, let's say the Bourbon dynasty, or the direct, like immediate relatives of Louis XVI. But he also had extended family, right? And the whole dynasty who might have belonged to the Bourbon family, or who was somehow associated or related with them, were going to, used to fall under the category of nobility. And then came the third state, which you can say pretty much combined of everybody. It was practically everybody, because how many priests or nobility do you think would be there in a country? Not many, right? So mostly everyone else, which was almost 90% of the population, fell under the third state. It comprised of big businessmen, merchants, peasants, artisans, servants, everyone, small peasants, big peasants, all of them used to fall under the lawyers, the teachers, professors, students, everyone, the women fell under the third estate. Okay, so this is how the division of the society was. But how is this useful for us? Why is this information going to affect our knowledge of taxation? So let's understand this very quickly. So there was an issue at that time in the society and with this segmentation. The biggest issue, which was the feudal system. Now, what do you mean by the feudal system? So guys, feudal system was basically a system under which people had big lands, okay? Because now we understand there was nobility, then there was clergy, and then there were few people who basically belonged to the lower strata of the society. So the major people, which were also part of the nobility, owned masses of land. So major land and properties and estates were owned by the second and the first state, the privileged class. Okay, why were they privileged? We will understand this. So what happened, the taxation that was being imposed, the people of the first and the second state were not a part of this. Now imagine they already have more money, they're more privileged, and on top of that, they're not even paying the tax. So who's paying the tax? The entire burden of the tax was imposed on the third state, which was the 90% of the population. And they were also not financially very strong. Now coming back to the feudal system, so the most of the land, okay, big lands were owned by the nobility or mostly the people of first or the second state. Now what they used to do was they would force people to work on their land, okay. Bonded laborers were there, laborers were forced to work on that land despite of their interest in working for those people, okay. They would render services from them. Now that was just not it. It's not that they would just render the services and that would be fine. On top of working over there, they even had to pay the tax, which was known as the feudal dues. That was another pain, that was another issue, okay. And then this was not just it. Now you can imagine peasants or most of the people are forming about 90% of the population, and they are not working for themselves. They are not profiting because they do not have land. Hardly anyone used to have lands because most of the lands were owned by the landlords, the people who were belonging to the first or the second state, right? So as a result of this, the peasants, or you can say the third state, was suffering a lot. Now, why were they suffering? It's not like they were just paying one kind of tax. There were multiple tax that was being imposed on them. Now, once they would cultivate, let's say they were having a harvest done. After that, it's not like already the land was not there. So all the profit used to go to the landowners majorly. And on top of that, they had to pay tax, and this tax was paid to the church. Okay, it was known as tithes. Now, what is this tithes that you understand? Is basically the tax that was shared by the peasants after their harvesting or cultivation, you could say, to the church in name of religion. Okay, maybe this would have been enough, but no, they wouldn't stop there. There was another tax called tithes, which was imposed on the third state by the government. So it was, that was not just it. They also had to pay another tax. So there were two taxes that they were paying. So you can imagine that they were already in pain. On top of that, they're paying the taxes, they're paying the feudal dues, which is not justified. That was so unjustified towards them. Now, just quickly revising what these terms are. So livret is unit of currency in France before 1794. Tithe is a tax levied by church comprising 1/10 of the agricultural produce. So as I told you guys, the moment they would cultivate, they had to pay some tax to the church, which was basically 1/10 of their produce. Now you can imagine already the land did not belong to them. And on top of that, whatever they were cultivating, which always was not a lot, 1/10 of that used to go to the church in form of taxation. So unfair, right? And then there was tail, which was tax to be paid directly to the state, to the government. Now this started the struggle of survival among the people. Obviously they did not have money already. On top of that, they're paying so much of taxes, and all the burden of these taxes is borne by the 90% of the population, which belongs to the third state, correct? So what was the struggle and how did it look like? So one major thing was happening at this time, guys. The population in entire Europe was increasing. Particularly in France, it was increasing very, very rapidly. Now, what happens when population increases? Demands of commodities, essentials also increases, including that of food. So as a result of the increasing population, the demand of food also increased. Now, the demand of food is increasing, but is the cultivation or the production of food also increasing? No, it was not proportionally increasing. As a result of which, the food fell short for the population. It was the requirement or the need of the food was not meeting the need or the demand of the food by the population. It fell short. Now, what happens when the increase, when there is an increase in demand of something whose which has a lower supply? Simple concept, we know whenever the demand is extra and the supply is low, the price, the value of that commodity, of that product always increases, it spikes up. So as a result of this, the prices of the bread, the prices of the food also spiked up. Okay, so population was increasing, food was not enough to meet their needs, and as a result of this, the prices of all the commodities, for that matter, food and all the services and everything, kept on increasing. Now, there was another problem that was happening at this time. As I told you, a feudal system was basically people working for bigger people, like peasants and all working for bigger people, where they were being paid wages, right? They were being paid wages on a daily purpose. Now, these wages were fixed by these owners, okay, by these landlords, by these people who were hiring others to work under them. Now, these wages have been fixed. As a result of which, what is happening, the wages are fixed, which means the salary that I'm receiving is fixed, but my expenses are increasing. Why are my expenses increasing? Because all those commodities which were available at a certain price earlier have now spiked up. Now, as a result of this, the expenses were not meeting the income, because the income is constant, but the price of the other stuff is increasing, which means if I was able to lead a good life, let's say in 5,000 rupees earlier, now the prices have increased, which means 5,000 rupees is going to fall short for me. Now, this is when I had sufficient. Imagine for the people who used to get paid very, very less. They wouldn't be able to meet their requirements because their salary is fixed, but the expenses are continuously increasing. The result of this was the gap between the rich and the poor kept on widening up. It kept on increasing, the gap between the rich and the poor, which was not really healthy for the society. Okay. Now, the situation kept on becoming worse. Why? Because of the climatic conditions, guys. Okay. The climatic conditions added to the misery of the people even more and more. They were very, very inconsistent. Sometimes they would bring drought. Sometimes they would bring hail. Now, no matter what kind of climatic changes were happening, there was always one result. Can you guess what happened to the harvests, to the production of the agricultural products? Obviously, because of the inconsistent climate or these changes, those productions got really, really hampered. Now imagine, the population is already increasing, the food is already short. On top of that, whatever production was happening because of the climatic changes is also getting hampered, which means whatever amount of food was possible or available for them is taking a toll even more, which means whatever could have been possibly available also got damaged, as a result of which the shortage of food even increased even more. As a result of this, the result of this was a crisis among everybody, especially the third state, especially with the people who were financially unstable. Now, what was this crisis? So now they were struggling for their survival. It came to that level. They did not even had enough money, food, anything to sustain their lives. This is known as subsistence crisis. So what do we mean by subsistence crisis? It is a condition where you're struggling even to survive with the crisis for basic things like food, basic amenities like food. Your livelihood is endangered. And that is what had happened with the people of France at that time. Now, this is with the third class, okay? This is with the third estate of the society. Now, we understood that there was basically two sections in which the society could have been majorly divided in. The first one was nobility and the clergy, which was the privileged class. The second was the unprivileged class, okay? Now, guys, these 90% were the people who formed the majority of the society. They did not have any power, but the entire taxation was imposed on them. Now, started developing a new class. So this whole system started dismantling, and there was a new setup being formed in the society with the growing of middle class. Now, who were these middle class people is what we need to understand. Okay, So these new middle class people were basically the educated people who now were prosperous as well. They were a part of the third estate only, but they had now prosperity, which means they had now financial stability, they had money, and they were also educated, which made them a little different from both the states existing. Now, where did they get this money from? So they were basically the traders who would trade in, you can say, woolen silk, and who had, you can say, who were lawyers. So all of these nature of jobs would bring them money, and that would also make them educated. Okay. So now, as a result of this, because of the awareness that they had, because they were more educated, because they were more stable, they would strongly profess against the privilege by birth. They were completely against the privileged system. They did not believe in having privilege among people by birth. Now, what an amazing idea, right? They had, because they were educated, their ideologies were wonderful. They would also profess that if somebody really needs to be privileged, that should not be by birth but by merit. People should earn their privileges. It should not just be by an accident of birth. And how could this be attained? So they would profess this ideas of equal laws, equal opportunities. These were the principles that they were professing, that people should have equal freedom, equal laws, equal opportunities. Okay. And this was done, these ideas were not just promoted by, you know that this was done by the educated people, but who were these educated people? So along with these ideas, the society also saw new philosophers. And these philosophers were coming with these ideas. And who were these philosophers? Few of them were Locke, Montesquieu and Rousseau. These are few well-renowned philosophers. Now guys, what do you mean by philosophy and what do we mean by philosophers? So philosophy is basically, and then we will also understand what were the different ideas of philosophers. Okay, so but let's quickly understand what do we mean by philosophy. So this is basically, you can say, people who give us some guiding principles of behavior, some ideas, some beliefs. These are known as philosophies, and people who have these philosophies of life, some ideologies which are great in nature, are known as philosophers, just as John Locke, Rousseau and Montesquieu. Now these people had some amazing out of the world ideas which used to differentiate them from everybody else in the society. But these ideas were so beautiful that it was welcomed by everybody. And not just that, it was not just welcomed, it was being discussed everywhere. Whether it was salon, whether it was bookstores, each and every place, these ideas were, you can say, running through the people's blood and talks and conversations. Not just that, even with the people who were illiterate, they were also getting familiarized with these ideas through conversations that they were hearing here and there. And these discussions would also happen in groups for people who were illiterate to get them known to the ideas of these great philosophers. Now, what were these ideas that these people were talking about? So let's talk about John Locke. So he actually wrote a book called Two Treatises of Government. Okay. Now this Two Treatises of Government spoke about two major ideas. One was, it denied the doctrine of the divine, and second, it said that the absolute right of monarch should not be there. Now what do we mean by this? Doctrine of the divine basically meant that he was saying that people treat the royal families, the family of the king or the queen, as if they are godlike, they are divine. That is something that people should not do. They are there to help the people, they are there for the people, and that's why they should not be treated as some godlike feature, figure. Okay, so that was the first thing that he denied. And the second thing that he denied was that absolute right should not be given to the monarch. The king should not have all the power among himself. It should be divided and given out to the society of the people. Okay. Then the second person who had great ideas just like John Locke was Rousseau. Now Rousseau kind of added on to the idea of John Locke, you can say. Okay, and he came up with a new term called, and in his book which he has professed, is social contract. Now, this was an amazing idea. Okay, what is a social contract? Social contract, you can see, is basically a social agreement. It's a base, it's a consent that two people come at, okay, with their consensus. They kind of agree on something. Now, who are these two people that Rousseau is speaking about? He's saying that the people, the citizens, and the representatives that they select should kind of have a contract, an agreement. It's not like I've selected you as my representative and now you can go and do whatever you want. There should be an agreement between our expectations, and expectation setting should be done between you and me if you're my representative and I have selected you as my representative. So the people who are selecting and people who have been selected as the representatives should have a consent, should have a contract, should have an agreement. Okay. Then was Montesquieu. Now the idea that he gave has been implemented, was implemented even in those 13 colonies which just got freedom with the help of France itself, and it has also been implemented in India. It's not something new, it's something that we are very, very familiar with. Now the idea of Montesquieu was that the power should not rely in one center. If you do that, there will always be imbalance. If you want to maintain a balance, a division of power among people on the same level should be done. Okay, so within the government, the power should be divided into legislature, the executive, and the judiciary. What a beautiful idea he gave, which is still being used by everybody. Now, as I told you guys, these ideas were so beautiful, so relevant, so people were resonating with their ideas so much that it spread like a wildfire among the people. It gained popularity between each and every one. As people were talking about it in the bookstores, in the, you can say, every gathering that they were there, in the salons wherever they used to sit together, this is what was the hot topic of discussion. Now, at the same time, it got even more aggravated, even more promoted, you can say more pushed, when at this time, so we know that the government needed taxes to be to run the country, right? They needed more and more money. As a result of which, at this time, King Louis the 16th increased the taxation. As a result of this, along with these ideas were already going on, it promoted it. It just pushed the anger and the protest among the people even more, and which further led to the, you can say, spread of the idea. Now we are going to understand that how this led to the outbreak of the revolution. How did the revolution even start? Okay, so as I told you, so the France, so the country was kind of divided in three segments. Now we are going to talk about France's old regime. What do we mean by old regime, people? So we basically mean that the society or the institutions that existed in France before 1789, that is what we refer to as old regime. Now, how did the institution or the setup of the society at this time look like? So we know that there was an absolute monarchy, but there was one catch over it. Okay, the monarch did not have the power to impose tax on people on his own. So there was something done, some catch was there to keep a check on his power. So now how he could have increased the power, because we know that Louis XVI wanted to increase the taxation. So how he could have done that? So if he wanted to impose more and more tax, he needed to call the estate general. Now we need to understand who the estate general was. So in people, estate general was basically a political body which you can say had the representatives from all the three estates, the clergy, the clergy, the nobility, and the third estate as well. Okay. And the idea was that the estate general will come together as an assembly. In an assembly, they will have a meeting. And if all of them approve of the idea which is being proposed, then it will get passed and the taxes will be imposed. So now this estate general was not called before 1614 in the country, in France before this. Now you can imagine, it was in 1614, which year are we right now in? 1789. So almost after 100, you can say, of years in a way, it was called. So after 1614, it is happening in 1789 on 5th of May. Bachcha, this date is very, very important. Remember that the State General was called on 5th May of 1789. Now, what was the purpose? The purpose was that Louis XVI wanted to increase tax and he needed the permission of the Estate General. So they were called. Now, what did this Estate General look like? So it comprised, as I told you, representatives of three sectors. So there were around 300 representatives from the clergy sector, 300 representatives from the nobility, and around 600 representatives from the third estate. Now, it might sound a little, fair, because let's say 50%, 600 were from the privileged class and 600 from the non-privileged class. But it was not so fair. Why? Because 90% of the population is what was comprising the third estate. And out of the 90% of the population, only 50% of the population representatives were present there in the Estate General, which was not so fair. As a result of this, and top of that, that was not the only problem. Let's say, okay, fine, we are 600, you are 600, together we can figure something out. But the pattern of the voting on top of it was so unfair that it was creating a clear unfair division among the people. So what was the voting pattern? It was not like each person had one vote. Each segment, each estate had one vote, which means there were three estates, so there will be three votes, one for each of them respectively. Now, how unfair is this? Because the first two estates are privileged, they would want to take actions which will always preserve their privileged estate. And the third estate will always fall short of majority. And also the first two states will always be working with the king and forming things which will be favorable for them. So as a result of this, the third state started asking for a new voting pattern, okay, which was that each person, one person should have one vote. This was their new proposal, okay, in order to, fight the old order of the society, which the people of the first and the second state wouldn't have let happen because they would have wanted to retain the order of the society, which was in their favor. Now, this demand was also something that Rousseau was also putting forward. So everyone else was kind of fighting for it. But do you think the king would have listened? Obviously not. He knew that if he would have listened to the third estate, the whole order would have just got dismantled. And even his idea of imposing tax on them wouldn't have helped him go further. So as a result of this, the king rejected their idea and their proposal. Now the third estate was furious. They were not at all happy, and as a result of this, they just stormed out of the assembly. This estate general that was happening, they stepped out of it, walked out of it in protest. Now then what happened? Now that they have walked out, now who were these people who walked out, guys? We just first quickly let's have an understanding of the crowd of the representatives of these third estate. Now obviously people who were not educated, who were not privileged, who were not prosperous couldn't have afforded to be a part of the representative community of the third estate, which means the people who were representing the third estate were not the true third estate, because there were a lot of peasants, laborers, the lower, very, very lower class of people. They were not a part of this assembly. That was another reason why they were not thinking of interest of anybody and could have and had, you can say, the courage to walk out without thinking of the consequences, which was both good and bad. Now, these people who have walked out obviously are not going to sit quietly. That's not the reason why they have walked out, right? The reason that they have walked out is to do something rebellious, to give an answer back to the monarch who is trying to make it autocratic, who's trying to practice absolute rule. So on 20th June 1789, so you see this was happening, this happened on 5th May 1789. After that, on 20th June 1789, the members of the third state met in a local place, which was the Hall of Indoor Tennis Court in the grounds of Versailles. Now, what did they do there? they came together and they declared that now they are going to be known as the National Assembly against the Estate General or against the ruler. They said that they will be known as the National Assembly, and they sworn, okay, they took this, you can say, resolution that they are going to form a new constitution for France, which is the idea of this constitution is solely going to limit the power of the king, which they felt was being too much absolute. Okay, now this assembly has been formed, a new group has been formed. Obviously, there has to be a leader of this group in order to lead it further, in order to make sure that the movement keeps on going further. Now, who were these leaders? Okay, so these leaders were Mirabeau and Abysseus. Okay, so Abysseus and Mirabeau were the leaders of this group. And who were these people? Mirabeau and Abysseus were actually people from the noble class, guys, but they were completely convinced. They knew the, you can say, the struggle of the third state and were actually in favor of them and wanted to do away with the feudal system. They wanted the privileged class to not be privileged by birth, by but by merits. They even believed in it. Mirabeau was actually a very powerful orator. Okay, he used to give some wonderful speeches and he would assemble the crowd of Versailles and would give them that energy, that motivation. At the same time, Abysseus used to write some influential, very, very influential pamphlets, which was also known as what is the Third Estate. So this is how we see the outbreak of the French Revolution happened. In the next class, we will be talking about what happened next, how did the society progress, what were the different steps, and how did the revolution go further. But before that, I have a quick homework question for you, which is, what is the name of the tax paid by the Third Estate to the state in 18th century? Teeth, tail, zollverein, or livre? And you have to answer it in the comment box, people, not in the live chat, so that your name can come in the fastest finger first. If you think this was really helpful for you, don't forget to hit on the like button and also subscribe to the channel so that you are immediately informed the moment we go ahead and release the next video, right? And I will see you very soon with the second session of the French Revolution, and we will see what happens next. It's going to be very interesting. Till then, stay home, stay safe. Take care, guys. Have a great day ahead. Bye-bye.